I have an announcement from the start of you. Is everybody here vaccinated? Okay, and now let's begin. Why? The question of perfect faith and man being passive because he believes in God, on the one hand, and man taking action, which might indicate a lack of faith, is the issue, the philosophical issue that's going on to do with this year. Does perfect faith demand that we simply trust God? And if we trust God, that means that we shouldn't do anything proactive. If God destined that we should be ill, we'll be ill. We don't have to vaccinate. If God destined that He'll protect us, He'll protect us. Why should we take a vaccination? On the other hand, perhaps, a kind of borrowed from once is to be proactive. And He gave us the intelligence to discover vaccinations and medicine. And He wants man to be part of that action. And therefore, if we don't vaccinate, then we're doing something stupid. And that's not what God wants us to do. God wants us to be intelligent, to do the right thing, to take control of our faith, and therefore to vaccinate. Now, the question is, if we look at Torah, we look at in a pure world, we should be coming to conclusions regarding philosophical issues with a total clean mind, simply looking at the Torah. I don't know why I kept it. Simply looking at the Torah. Is it okay now? You're vaccinated, right? Okay. It's okay now? You can hear? Everybody here? Yes? Okay. In a pure world, we should be looking at the Torah with a total clean mind, without any preconceived notions, not influenced by outside sources, and to try to discover what the Torah tells us to take one position or the other position. The problem is that it's impossible to be in a pure world. Man lives within a certain context, he has certain, there are meanings and influences, and the Torah was given to who has those influences, so it's impossible to approach Torah totally with a clean frame of reference without any leanings. And therefore, the whole idea of giving Torah to man is in order for man to take his intelligence in the place where he is and his understanding and to apply them and try to understand the Torah. Nevertheless, there are places where it would appear that certain ideas in the Torah or certain ways in which the Mefarshim explain those ideas might run counter to what we feel is the right way, and then we're in a dilemma. Now, what we're going to do is discuss one particular case, a case that appears to last a total of 3 years, which sort of lies at the root of the question that I asked before. Do we go to doctors or do we say to help? We say in Shemera, or do we vaccinate? What should we be doing? It also goes to the roots of religious Zionism. When we talk about Zionism, we begin with secular Zionism, which says, we don't wait for Mashiach anymore, we don't pray to God, we're going to take our destiny into our own hands. And we're going to solve the problem of anti-Semitism that's a result of the exile, and we're going to do whatever we can to go back to Israel. The response of non-religious Zionism is really an attack on that whole approach. We do believe in God. We will wait for Mashiach. Afro T-shirt, Amea, Achakelo, with an underline on the word, Achakelo. We will wait. We will wait, we will pray, we'll do mitzvos. If we want to bring the Gula, it's not by having conferences and putting pressure on world leaders. It's by doing tshuva, Masa Tovim, and praying to our Kodesh Baruch Hu. And in fact, if you take a look at source number 3, the Gemara of Straus, which is one of the main sources of the Satmar rejection of religious Zionism, is a Gemara of Straus that talks about 3 oaths that that were taken, but I'm going to point out two of them. Gimel Shvut, Achat Shelo Ya'alu Yisrael B'chola, one that the Jewish people after, post-Straus, should not return to Israel by force. V'achat Sh'Shpi'a Kadosh Baruch Hu, and Yisrael Shelo Yimudu B'mot HaOlam. We shouldn't go against the B'mot HaOlam, the other nations. We should be passive, we should wait. And God will bring us the redemption. I'm not going to discuss right now the ways to answer this Gemara, that's not my issue. But that there's an ideology of Satmar. The ideology of Satmar is that pure faith is waiting for God. And to try to take things, actions into your own hands is a lack of that pure faith. I just brought a section here from Seahurst College there. So from before, there are many things that can be found there before. Bal yachshov ha-koshev ki pe'om yeyein Hashem yiparach mishamayim la'aretz ne'mor la'amot tzedu. Don't think that the way that the redemption is going to come is that all of a sudden God will come down from the heavens and tell the Jews to go back to Eretz Yisrael. O yishlach mishu pe'om yin ha-shamayim, suddenly somebody will appear, the tkor b'shofar gadol in Eretz Yisrael, and then all of a sudden blow a great trumpet. V'yaseh chomat ish saviv, and there'll be a wall of fire around. And then it continues, kol divan adim yitkayu, the words of the prophets will be fulfilled. V'achvite yamin, v'shtemu ta'u ulam. Avo medabrim al yamin. What is achvite yamin? Achvite yamin begins now. This is what Seahurst College said, one of the founders of religious Zionism. Religious, he said, achvite yamin, the end of days begins now. It will happen eventually through normal geopolitical actions. Israel will come peace by peace. But Sierra Kalsha was not rejecting God, but he felt that the way in which the redemption will come is through human action. And that human action is legitimate, because God turns to man and says, man, I want you to be proactive. And therefore, being proactive is not a rejection of God, but it's actually fulfillment of the divine plan. Let's go back to Yosef and the Sarah Mafri. The difficulty begins with the pasuk after Yosef interprets the dreams of the Sarah Ophir with Sarah Mashkin. He tells the Sarah Mashkin, you will be taken back to Paro. So he says, Kim Zichatan, you should remember me to Paro, so that I'll be taken out of jail, out of prison. And then the Pasuk says, V'lo Zachar Sarah Mashkin et Yosef Barishtachim. And the obvious difficulty is the repetition, the unnecessary repetition. If you don't remember, you forgot. Why does that have to say you didn't remember and also you forgot? So take a look at Rashi's source number one. V'lo zachar sar mashkim bo hayom v'yishkacheyu l'achar mikan. He didn't remember that day, and then also later he forgot it. B'pnei shekala bo Yosef bitfono l'zachro, since Yosef made himself dependent on the sar mashkim, the next pasuk is like, he had to wait another 2 years. He was punished. And he had to wait another 2 years till he was free. You should put your faith in God. And Rashi interprets, you shouldn't go trust and put your faith and try to tell the Sarah Mashkin, who's an Egyptian, to take you out. Put faith in God. Now, there are two ways of understanding why Yosef is being punished, at least two ways at this point. One, because he lacked faith in God. And he trusted only the Sarah Mashkin, and he didn't put his faith in God. That position, I think, is difficult. One of the things that we see Yosef does over and over again is an extreme faith in God. When he interpreted the dreams of the Sarah and Sarah Mashkin, he saw that they were beside themselves. He said, Kilo Kim Pitonim. Tell me your dreams. God has interpretations of dreams. Tell me your dreams. Maybe I can help to understand what God wants from you. It's clear that Yosef is a man of faith. And to say that all of a sudden he didn't put trust in HaKadosh Baruch Hu anymore, I think it's a very, very difficult position to take. And Rabbi Bachya, in source number 4, picked up on this problem. Baal Yachshon HaChoshe, I'm sorry, V'chas V'shalom, source number 2. V'chas V'shalom She'itle Yosef HaTzadik B'tchonot B'sar HaMashkim, Rav HaShem L'Ado, God, Yosef faith in God. אבל הייתה קוראתו שהשם יתעלה הזמין אליו שר המשכים כדי שיעשה לו מסעדו. He felt that the reason that all of a sudden this chance occurs to happen and all of a sudden in his cell there's the שר המשכים who has this dream and he's going to be feeding, he's going to go back to Paro, there must be a reason. God wants me to ask the שר המשכים to help. כי מן הידוע, it's common knowledge שהצלת הקדוש ברוך הוא את הצדיקים הייתי ספוטו. Then how will the righteous be free? By events. Not by miracles, by events. And here, this is the event. This is the opportunity. ומה שנענש, why was Yosef punished? ואחרי שם שתי שנים עוד, for another 2 years, כמו שדרשו לזל, זה היה על דיבור שדיבר את שר המשכים. He should have been passive. He shouldn't have done anything. Yes, he was right. The Sar Mashkin was put there, he had his dream, in order that he should hear Yosef, that he's interpreting the dreams. And he should go back to Paro, and Yosef should be taken out. Yosef should have just been passive, not done anything. So here's the issue. What's wrong if Yosef doesn't believe in God to take action? Is that a problem? What's wrong if you believe in God, you're sick, you say to Helen, you say to Shabera, and you also go to a doctor. What's wrong? Is there any pagam in also being active? Is Rashi coming against any human action and saying that it's a lack of pure faith? Pure faith demands that man sit back and just wait for God and do nothing? That's the root of the philosophical dilemma that we're dealing with. What I want to do is reread the Yosef story and maybe get a different insight into the story, which will help us to understand what might be the problem that Rashi and Rabbi Shem Chazal are dealing with. Let's go back to the beginning of the story. In the beginning of the story, Yosef has his dreams, he tells the dreams to the brothers. And how are we supposed to understand dreams? How did Yaakov understand the dream? When Yaakov heard the dream, what did Yaakov say? First of all, he recognized Yosef. Take a look at Ma Chalom Azir Shachalam, what's this dream that you have? At the beginning of Yeshiva. Perklav Zayin, Pasuk Yud. Machol Azer Shechalach, what's this dream that you have? And what is Yaakov saying when he says, what is this dream that you have? He knows that he has a dream. So the Rabban points out that the question is, what's the significance of the dream? Source number 5, Vitam ma chalom azeh shechalamta kemo ma adam v'teda eyu klo ma chalom azeh eino klum shetagidem. Was it something that's worth telling other people about? Ki eino el dvar v'teda. It's nonsense. Oh, perhaps, it was only a dream. That's not going to carry away. You had a dream. Oh, hagara lomar eich nasa'acha liba lachlom achalom azeh. אין זה כאילו גוב עלי ונערות שיעלה דברים כאילו על אותך. What does Rabban say? That Yaakov Avinu was a psychologist. What you dream of at night is what you're thinking about in the day. You're a spoiled brat. You think that you are better than all your brothers and therefore you're having these dreams. In other words, is it necessary to say that a dream is some kind of divine revelation? Or is it possible that a dream are a result of what a person thinks? That's what Rabban puts into the mouth of Yaakov. What are you thinking? There's a very nice pasuk in Yeshayahu Chavtes. V'yakasher yachalom hara'ed v'ine ochel v'ekis v'ekamashom. Somebody who's starving, he dreams of food, and then he wakes up and he's hungry. In other words, Yeshayahu also knew that dreams can be a result of the state of life. So dreams are not necessarily indication of some kind of divine revelation. On the other hand, the pasuk continues, "Va'aviv shamar et hadavar," because Yaakov recognized that perhaps it might be a dream that has significance. Yaakov himself had a dream which was very, very important for him when he was running away from Esau, the dream of the ladder. So dreams might be an indication of something divine, but it might be an indication of a state of mind. Yaakov was ambivalent. What did Yosef think about the dream? I think that's obvious. Yosef was convinced this was a sign from heaven. I think it's a little bit stronger than that. Yosef, why did Yosef tell the dream to his brothers? Okay, he had a dream, he knows he's destined to rule over his brothers. Why did he tell it to his brothers? Okay, we already established he's a spoiled guy. Why did he tell the dream to his brothers? We'll see later on there's a Ramban that says not only did Yosef believe that this was a divine sign, Yosef was proactive in trying to make sure that the dream would reach its fruition, that the dream would be fulfilled. He tried to act to make sure that that dream would come true. Now, he won't be able to believe his brothers unless he tells them that he had this dream. But more so, there's a very strange story when Yosef goes to find his brothers. Yaakov sends him, go see how your brothers are. Go to Shem. He goes to Shem. He doesn't find his brothers. Right? And he finds a person who says, why are you wandering here? And then the person says, oh, your brothers went to Dothan. And then Yosef continues on to Dothan. Why is that story so important? That story of going to Shem, not finding him in Shem, meeting this person, random person, who obviously is planted by God, and then going to Dothan. Why is that so important? Let me ask you another question. Wasn't Yosef aware that his brothers hated him? Was he not able to see that? He couldn't even speak to him. I'm sure there was yelling in the house of Yaakov all the time. We know that something was off. Now they left. They went away. So I'm sure he didn't think they would try to kill him. But a few punches, you know, I'm sure weren't beyond the possibility. Was he nervous when he went? He didn't only go to Dothan. He went direct to his Tanakh Pasim, showing his superiority over his brothers. Now, I think the story of going to Shem and not finding him, and then going on to Dothan, if he wanted to, it was only to fulfill the wishes of his father, he could have said, you know what, I went to Shem, they're not there, come back. He went on, not because he was trying to fill the wish of his thoughts. It's a beautiful option. Source number 6. Amnon Yosef gam ki yada ki ra'a bo vava. He knew his brothers hated him. Ruach acheret imo. Omer b'libo mi yoridei aretz. Hashem he'elani gam ala alachim. God, through my dreams, made me superior to all my brothers. I'm not worried about what they think of me. I'm not worried that they hate me. It doesn't bother me at all. God made me superior over them. Ki ko her ani Hashem. That's what God showed me, the vision. Vinei anachnu alumnim alumnim v'tocha sadeh. V'yishtachavu alumatam l'alumati. And their bundles bowed down to mine. And therefore, v'ein zeh. He im elchali eitzei asadeh. I have to go to the fields. Where did that dream occur? in the field. And therefore, I have to go meet my brothers in the field so that they will bow down to me. He continues on to Dothan. Even though his father didn't demand that he go to Dothan, he wasn't worried about anything because I'm going to go there because that's going to be the fulfillment of my dream. Why should I feel it? God is with me. Haim yuchlu heim levatel sha'ash she'omedet li me'ato yiparach. This is the moment we've been waiting for. I'll go to the field, I'll meet them, they'll bow down to me. They can't do anything about it. It's in the stars. Al-kein tshilat dvar ha-malach, the person who meets, according to the Al-Sheikh, is a divine angel, a messenger. Hayam asir to'em libo, ba yiftach b'chalolot. You shouldn't have such absolute faith in your dreams. Even assuming that this is the interpretation, lo tirna b'chilatach, and here's something interesting, nevertheless it doesn't take away the chilat chashus, we're not going to discuss that. V'al yiftach mish'enet kaneh ratzutz, ha'u b'chalolot, umagav, this is the thing that's critical for me, ki ein ze pitron chalolot ha'u k'medubah. You have no idea how to interpret this dream. V'zeh v'yitzei ish v'neto et basadeh. The person found him, the angel found him, el v'uto et basadeh. He says, why say basadeh? It should be bisadeh. Basadeh is basadeh ha'yadua. In that sadeh, in the kin sadeh, in the known sadeh. What's the known sadeh? He says, v'yei anachnu ma'omim alumni b'toch ha'sadeh. It's the dream. You are misinterpreting your dream. You don't know what it means. A little bit more you know about. You don't understand the dream. In that sadeh of your dreams, you are misinterpreting. I think the Al-Shaf's interpretation is brilliant. I don't know if it's Pshat, but there is this indication that Yosef is really very, very sure of himself. Because he's coming on with his dream, and he's not worried about anything. And if he wanted to, he could have turned back. And he goes on. What the Al-Shaf adds is that he goes on because he wants to proactively create the situation whereby his dream is fulfilled. That's a very, very important thing, which we'll get back to. What do the brothers think about the dream? Do they believe that it was a divine sign? He comes, Vinei Balachalot al-Zeba. The dreamer came. What do they think about? The simple explanation is they thought it was just the dreams of the spoiled brat. A very annoying spoiled brat. The Ramban notes that interpretation. Source number 7. Let's see, we'll throw him to a wall, we'll kill him, and we'll see what will happen to his dreams. It's derision. If we kill him, let's see whether the dreams will be fulfilled. The Nachon Be'nai, the second interpretation, Kiyanu Atanu E' Mayu Chalomotav. It's a test. In other words, we don't know. Just like Yaakov didn't know was a Bibliot, is it a real dream or is it a fake? We'll throw him to a wall, we'll kill him, and if somehow he gets out of it, then we'll know it's a real dream. It's a test. And then he has Avor Rabotei Pirshu, he has a Medrash, that the Nir'eh Ma'iru Chamotav is Ruach HaKodesh. It's not the brothers saying it, even if they said it, but we hear the echo of Ruach HaKodesh says, we'll see. You say it won't happen, I say it will happen. We'll see what will happen. Okay, in any case, it's clear that the brothers don't give much stock into these dreams. They think it's just a problem in the state of mind. It's not anything divine. And they really, really hate those things. They take him. They strip him of his Kitab HaPasim, which is very, very symbolic, you know, the thing that gives him a certain amount of superiority over his brothers. They throw him into a war. What happens to Yosef? Is he so full of confidence, brimming of confidence, and saying, I don't care, I'm not worried, God will help me? Or was this a little bit of a shock, and all of a sudden, he takes a step back? There's a pasuk. Perek Membet, pasuk Tafalif, that the brothers, later on, when they come down during the years of famine, they say, Vayomu Yishalachi, Aval Ashimim Anachnu, we're guilty. Alachinu Asherayim Tzorat Nafsho, B'tchanu Adem Rosh Hashanah. We heard him cry out, and we didn't listen. We turned a deaf ear when he was crying out. In other words, although nothing is said in Parsha Vayeshu, Yosef starts pleading for his life. He's not so sure of himself anymore. He was stripped of his uniform of superiority, thrown in the bar. He's not confident anymore, loses his security, cries out. He's not so sure. Was it a real dream? Was it the bomb? Maybe not. All of a sudden, his confidence clearly is shaken. When he's sold, instead of being killed and he's sold into slavery, he goes down to Egypt. What he thinks during these years or during those months, I don't know. I don't know. But there's no doubt that, I'm not no doubt, but what happened when he all of a sudden, in the cell, hears the dream of the Sara Ophim and Sara Mashkin. And this is really the point of the story where he asked the Sara Mashkin to remember him. And according to Rashi and the Medrash, he made a mistake. And there are two possibilities. One possibility is he gave up on his dreams. He has no idea whether or if they will ever be fulfilled, or whether there was a real divine sign. No more confidence. And now this is the opportunity to get out of jail and to come back and to crawl back to his family. And if that's the case, I see no problem at all with his trying to use whatever means in his ability to try to get out. But there's another possibility which I want to try to claim, that when all of a sudden he heard the dream of the Sara Mashkin, his all of a sudden he realized that there's a possibility that his dream will be fulfilled. All of a sudden he realized, he heard a dream. Now dreams are very important. Now there's dreams are also interconnected because they're a sign of an indication of what will be in the future of destiny. And the dream of the Sara Mashkin fits in all of a sudden with his dreams. All of a sudden there's a road back. Why was Sara Mashkin placed here? Why did he have this dream? Why did he tell him this dream? It's interesting the term that Yosef uses when he tells about Sara Mashkin, Ki'in Zechatai, as if it's a condition. I'll explain to you the dream, you will get out, you will go back to power. Ki im zechatai, as if it's dependent upon that, you will remind or tell power about me. I would like to suggest that at this point, maybe beforehand also, but at this point, Yosef once again, all of a sudden sees that the road to fulfilling his dream is open. Gunav Ganafi, I was stolen, I was sold to slavery, and here is my ticket to freedom. The Sara Mashkin is my ticket out of Egypt and back to Eretz Canaan. And once I get back to Eretz Canaan, I will be able to fulfill the dreams. Even if we accept it on bond that the brothers didn't know, if somehow he manages to get back after all that they had done, Even the brothers would realize that was a real vision. But what happens? He's forgotten for 2 years. It doesn't work. What does this tell us? Again, this interpretation of dreams. My main question is, at this point, does he believe in his dreams, or did he stop believing in his dreams? That's a critical question. It depends on a number of different things. The Rabbah in general felt that even at this point, the Rabbah, the Yosef is trying to, once he rises and 2 years later, he's taken out of the bar, he attempts at having his dream fulfilled. He believes in his dream. I think that comes from Rabbah, when he was taken out and he's in the presence of Paro, and he interprets the dream, and he says, what you have to do is appoint Ish Navol Vechai, an intelligent person, a person of insightful intelligence, and talk to him over Egypt, and he will save Egypt. During the years of plenty, he will gather all the food, and that will save Egypt also during the years of famine. And then, Paro's response is, once you've told me all this, you are that Ishtabon of Chafa. And then at this point, Yosef is appointed as the viceroy of Egypt. According to Rabban, this is planned by Yosef. By saying, appoint Ishtabon of Chafa, it was a way of hinting that you should appoint me. That's the way the Rabban interprets it. And I think, again, according to Rabban, he feels that this is the ticket to fulfillment of dream, not the way he thought originally. It'll come differently. I will become a leader in Egypt, and somehow, eventually, that will bring the dream to fruition. I'm not sure I accept that meeting, and I'll explain to you why. First of all, the election of Yosef to this position was, I think, the most unexpected possibility. Egyptians did not like Ivri, they couldn't eat with Ivri. Here was an Eved Ivri who was accused of attempted rape of an Egyptian minister. So, okay, he took his dreams. He should become royalty in Egypt. He never claimed he was an Ishmael of Chacham. He claimed that he had some divine insights. He said, let's go to the pasuk. He said, basically, et Hashem Elokim Ra'ah Ra'ah Farol, God is showing you things. He presents himself as being somebody who is able to understand God's will. And Paro says, "Hanitzar kaze isha shemruach elokimbo." It's a person of spiritual qualities, not necessarily intelligence. Then, by your Paro Yosef, acharei odia elokimbo b'chad kozot. Since you understand God's will, ein navon b'chacham kamocha. You are that intelligent person. That should be you. He showed himself as being somebody of religious value, not somebody of intelligent value. And nevertheless, despite that, even though you present yourself as somebody of religious insight, you will be appointed because Ein Avon L'Chacham Kamocha. Now, the Midrash, source number 8 is the Rambam that I pointed out before. Amar Yosef Kol Zeh Bavor Sheyit Chalubo Ki HaChacham Inon Rosho. And it was a way of getting power to appoint him. Well, appoint him every kid and came to Vikesh Power on Lichet Yosef, Abu Kosak, and Dimshalo, Yish Eben Melech. It was an absurd choice. But the plan, it wasn't so simple. There are other indications we don't have the plan for right now. But my main point is, at this point, did Yosef really try to fulfill his dreams? Or did Yosef forget? What did he call his two children? What were their names? Menashe and Ephraim. Why Menashe? Kinashani, God help me forget all my troubles. Ephraim, Ki Ephraim Hashem Be'eretz Avi. Okay? God help me forget all my troubles. Ve'et Beit Avi. God help me forget my family, my troubles. I forgot them. Of course, if you name your son Menashe because you forgot it, but you didn't forget. But it means that you want to forget. Ki Ephraim Elokim Be'eretz Avi. Everything is perfect here, it's wonderful. But nevertheless, he calls it Eretz Avi. So there's ambivalence. But is he trying to get back to Eretz Canaan and to rule over his brothers? Or is he trying to forget? He was almost killed by his brothers, sold into slavery. It was traumatic. Does he want to forget that? Or does he want to go back there? What's can a shadow of king of call a new big of me? Is he trying to fulfill his dreams, or is he trying to forget? I think it's clear that at this point he's trying to forget. And also the road back to Eretz Canaan, once he's appointed by the story, is closed. He can't come back to Eretz Canaan because he has a job in Egypt. When does all this change? It changes when, around 8-9 years later, there's a famine in the entire Mesopotamia, and the brothers come to Egypt. Pasuk 10. Right? The brothers come, and then a little bit before that it says, "Vayavo achei Yosef, pasuk vav, vayishtachu aparaz they bow down to him, vayayo Yosef et achav, vayakirem he recognized them, they didn't recognize him, vayidaber itam kasho he started being difficult with them." Vayake Yosef et Achav, Ve'lo Kiru, they didn't recognize him. Vayizkor et Chalotav. Now all of a sudden he remembers. If you remember now, till now you forgot. Now all of a sudden, the memory of his dreams are rekindled. Now all of a sudden he sees clearly how it's all going to be fulfilled. Now, at this point, when the brothers come down to Egypt, all of a sudden he sees, now he interprets the dream correctly. They come down to Egypt, they bow down to him, he remembers the dreams, and now all of a sudden it's all clear. Till now it wasn't at all. Kinasani, God help me forget, but now all of a sudden it's clear what his destiny is. What does Yosef do at this point? According to Rabbi, what he does, well, the Rabbi asks a question. Why didn't he, when he was a ruler in Egypt, why didn't he send a messenger to his father and say, Dad, I'm okay. I'll come back in another 14 years. And the Rabbi's answer is that Yosef realized that he hadn't yet fulfilled his dreams and that he had to ensure that those dreams would be fulfilled. So he allowed his father to remain in a state of despair and bereavement, because if he would reveal himself to his father, the dreams would not be able to be fulfilled. That's the position of the Rabbah. The Akedah Yitzchak, Rabbi Yitzchak Rambam, argues on the Rabbah. Source number 12. ותנהני, ומה שכתב רמב״ם, שעשה כדי שיתקיימו חלומותיו, כי מה תועלת לו שיתקיימו? ואף כי יהיה תועלת, לא היה לו לחתור כנגד אביו. Could a man further the divine plan? Should Yosef be proactive in in trying to make the divine plan come true? Furthermore, is that a good excuse for having his father remain in despair? What's beyond, what lies at the root of the Akedatistic's argument is a famous line of Braavos, source number 13, which talks about a meeting of Yishayahu Navi and his father. Write a will, you're going to die. That's what Yishayahu tells the scale, he's sick, you're going to die. You're going to die in this world, not only is Yishayahu one of the best kings, not only will die in this world, you're not going to have the next world either. What's going on? What did I do so terrible? You didn't do a mitzvah period early, you don't have children. Amalei should be chazayim ruach hakodesh. Denach minay b'nim lo ma'ali. I know who my children will be. Menashe, they'll be terrible kings. I don't want to have those children. They're going to destroy Israel. Amalei, dahadei kavshig rachmano lamalach. Why are you involving yourself in the hidden plans of God? My demafkinit ibalach lameben. You do your mitzvahs. That's your job. Umat edecha kamei kodesha brifu lameben. And God will do his job. In other words, there is a limit to human involvement. There are things that are godly and man does not get involved in. And there are things that are human and man does get involved in. Yeah. So, if you saw the Ruach HaKodesh, these are to be your children, and that's what Jewish destiny, that's what it's supposed to be. So by not choosing, you're going to change Jewish destiny? But how do you capture your heart alone? It's not your job. You do what man is supposed to do. What you're supposed to do is have children. God will do what he's supposed to do. And Yaakov Kavnetsky says it very nicely. Source number 13. Va'achfar ani tachas kapot raglav of the Ramban. I'm nothing compared to the Ramban. Avol hachi mitzvi l'kayim chalamot. Is it a mitzvah to push forward the fulfillment of dreams? Afilu miyad yet yegashi kayim emet. Even if you know it's a real dream, are you supposed to be involved in how the dream gets fulfilled? Is that part of human action? V'chol zol tachi alam v'shtadeh b'zeh. It's out of the realm of human action. It's out of Iyun. I wasn't able to understand any of the answers. Okay, so I'll give you a good answer. A good answer is that Yosef is trying to follow God's plan and Chizkiyahu is trying to thwart. So I can answer. But what Yaakov Kavnetsky and Akedah are raising in important issues, what they see with the Gemara Brachos, is that there's an area in which human action is legitimate, and there's another area in which human action is illegitimate. How divine plan should come to fruition, that's not legitimate. If God told Paro, there'll be a famine, and you know that will be preceded by years of plenty, so God is saying, do something about it. You can't change destiny. You can't say, bring about the famine or bring about the years of plenty. But if you have that knowledge, there's something you can do about that in the real world. Collect the food, gather the food, and then you won't starve. But that's within the human area of involvement and action. Are you supposed to make sure? Are you supposed to, there's supposed to be a famine? Let me burn down all the fields so that the famine would happen. Is that legitimate human action? That's what Yaakov Kavnetsky says. One can understand the Gemara Brachos in one of two ways. That really, if you want to try to be involved in Jewish destiny, it might be legitimate, but not when it comes at some price. If it means not doing your mitzvahs, first and foremost, do what you're free to do. And the problem was that you didn't lo asaku peregrin. But the Gemara Brachos seems to say that it's not only that you didn't do the mitzvah, but it's also that let God do what God does. that's not your involvement. That's not something you have any way of influence. I want to suggest the second reading, which I think is supported by the African Christianity itself. You know, the problem is not only that because he's trying to create a situation whereby, you know, navigate a course whereby his dreams will be fulfilled, because of that he wasn't a kind Mitzvah of Kibbutz Abayim, and his father suffered, but it's not an avenue that he should be treading on at all. God will figure out how to fulfill the dream. Man does what's right within the human arena. Don't get involved in God's arena. Okay, at this point, from this point on, when the brothers come down, Yosef has a plan. He sticks to his plan, he holds all the cards, and the plan seems to be done faultlessly. He knows exactly, he's going to take them, he's going to put them in jail, and they'll go back, and eventually they're going to have to come back, because they need food. And then he'll plant the Gavia, and he'll be able to get them all to come back, including Yaakov. And he holds all the cards. He knows what they don't know, and they don't know what he knows. And everything goes along for this, see? According to plan. And then, let's take a look at the beginning of the Yigaf. When he eventually wins, if anything, you know, he reveals himself to his brothers, and he says, "I'm Yosef." Yes, this is his point of victory, triumphant, and he has the benevolence of a victor, and he tells them, let's take a look at Parakmet Hei Pasuk Hei, "Va'ata al te'atzvu va'licha b'nechem kinecha t'mutiena." Don't feel bad that you sold it to Egypt. God sent me to help you survive. I am the messenger of God, you know, to help you survive. You didn't send me, God sent me, I am God's messenger. Okay, go to my father and tell him, Samani Elokim Ladon Amitzrayim. God appointed me ruler over all of Egypt. Okay? Okay, this is triumphant. Yosef, victorious. He's the messenger of God. They were only pawns in the divine plan. He knew the plan, and now it's all coming to fruition. But now things begin to unravel. And he tells them to come down for how long? There are another 5 years of famine. Why did they go back after the 5 years? Yaakov, when he comes down, he says, "I'm going to come down just to see my son." Why does he go back? On the way down to Egypt, all of a sudden he has a dream, a vision. "Al tirab meredam Mitzrayim, don't worry." And Yaakov understands that the exile is beginning. Yaakov understands the exile is beginning. What went wrong? Why couldn't they go back? Yosef, right? Plan went fortressly. He brings them down. He can support them. But all of a sudden, it's not Yosef supporting his brothers. All of a sudden, Paro hears, and he says, "I want you to bring the brothers to me." We're running out of time, so I'll say it about Paro. Won't go to the sources. Rashi says it means, "Come to, I'll give you a Goshen." But later on, Yosef engineers a plan. You go to Paro and you tell him, "We are shepherds, and therefore Paro will place you in Eretz Goshen." In other words, Paro wanted to bring him to his palace. He thought this is wonderful. Yosef, his family came, "Come to my palace, Bo Eli, and I'll give you the best of Eretz Yisrael of Egypt." And Yosef has to engineer a plan whereby they will be placed far from the palace to be in Eretz Goshen and to be able to continue as a Jewish nation. But Paulo basically wants to adopt them and bring them into royalty. When, at the end of the Akedah, how do the Egyptians look at Yosef and his family? Look at Egyptian royalty. Yosef gives them lechem lefi ataf, and the next pasuk says lechem ein b'chol eretz yisrael. He supports them, he gives them everything they need, but the people of Egypt are starving. He buys all the fields of all the Egyptians. They don't have any field, and the pasuk right after that he buys all the fields, it says at the end of Vayigash, Vayeshem Yisrael Beretz Yisrael, Beretz Goshen, Vayiachazuba, Vayifu, Vayimbo Me'od. Right? The Egyptians had no bed, he gives bed to his brothers. The Egyptians had no land, he gives land to his brothers. Vayifu, Vayimbo Me'od, here a little bit, beginning of Straus, Vayimbo Me'as Me'od Me'od, and the Egyptians start resenting B'nai Yisrael. But where do things really break? And the things really break, in my opinion, is when Yaakov dies, or about to die, and he tells Yosef, bury me in Eretz Canaan. And Yosef says yes. And Yaakov says swear. Why did he say swear? Why couldn't he trust Yosef? And then later on, when he tells Paro, Rashi says, I did not swear on everybody. Yosef, he tells Paro, Vata Elena Bekurat Aviva Shuva, I'll go and bury my father and I'll come back. Why do you have to say come back? Do people want to stay in Levaya? They don't they always come back from some place? What's Rosh Shuva? Why does it say, B'chol Beit Yosef, Yachavu Beit Aviv, Rak Tata Mitzvah B'Kram Azdu Be'er Choshev? They went up with everybody and they left their cattle. When was the last time you took your cattle to Levaya? They go up, Gam Rechet Gam Parashit, with the entire army. What's clear is, let's just take a read a story I heard from our salvation and then I can hopefully become clear. In 1954, the family of Baron Rothschild decided to move his remains and those of his wife to Ramat Tanagim and Zichron Yaakov Israel. When General Charles de Gaulle heard of the plans, he called James Rothschild, the Baron's youngest son, and said, I always considered members of the Rothschild family loyal friends to me. Only different regarding religion. But let me ask you, who is a good friend to me? One who was reared in France, educated in a French school, whose native tongue is French, who is ready to take up arms to defend France, and one who is buried in French soil when he dies. I can't imagine a good Frenchman whose remains are moved elsewhere. I knew the Baron and had unlimited faith in him. I always defended him from those who doubted his loyalty to France. Now I see there is some truth to those accusations. It's looked at as treason. Paro looked at Yosef and his family as royalty. When Yaakov dies, he's embalmed, like the pharaohs were. 70 days of national mourning. And then Yosef has to say, by the way, my father made me take an oath to be buried in his ground. All of a sudden, Yosef is no longer a royal Egyptian. All of a sudden, Yosef is a Jew. A Jew whom you can't trust. He has different loyalties. All of a sudden, everything that was given to them, lechem lefi ataf, the land that was given to them, how the Egyptians look at it now? All of a sudden, Yosef realizes that his plan, which he understood so totally, and he felt he was in control, that all of a sudden he realized that he was a pawn in God's divine plan. We took a look at the psukim of triumphant Yosef. In Torah is Yosef. I was the messenger of God. God sent me as a messenger in order to that you should survive. I was the messenger. God sent me. I. Let's take a look at the parallel psukim at the end of Vayechi. When the brothers come and they fail, Yaakov died. Now Yosef will take retribution. Parallel pasuk yutet vayomer lehem Yosef al tira'u ki atachat Elohim ani. Am I instead of God? Atem chashatem alai ra'av. That I was sent, but this was God's plan. What you have here is a humble Yosef. A Yosef that all of a sudden realizes that he did not understand the divine plan. He did not understand what destiny God had in store. He thought he held all the cards, and he was an unassuming pawn in ensuring that they shall go to God. I think that if one reads the story very well, that from the beginning, Yosef is trying to have his plan, his dream implemented. Because he doesn't only have the dream, but he tells them the dream. And he goes to, from Dothan, he goes to Dothan with his daughter Pasim in order to implement his dream. When he sees that he has this whole plan, that he will implement the dream, even though it causes his father despair and pain. And what our first prophet tells him is, Atachat Elohim Ani. What our first prophet tells him is, that what you should be doing? Are you supposed to be involved in implementing the dream? When you met the Sarah Mashkin and you told him, King Zechartani, because you thought, this is the ticket to fulfillment of the dream, is that what you should be doing? Is that legitimate human action? Or is that beyond the border? That's a Hasagas Gvul. And that's where all of a sudden man is encroaching upon God's plan. And in God's plan, man never sees the full picture. Even if you think you do, you don't really see the full picture. What's wrong with it is humility. God will fulfill the plan the way he wants. What man has to do is what man should do. And just to bring it home, we believe in real Zionism. Human action to come to build Yeshua, to build Yisrael, to make it a Medina, which is based on ethics, it's based on Torah values. And we feel, and we do missiles and Torah, we have to make Iyun in order to further God's plan. But that's human action. Should we blow up the Temple Mount so that there will be a jihad and God's hand will be forced to save the people? Is that legitimate human action? To force God's hand and to be involved with God's plan? Or to do things which we can do in this world? Religious Zionism is doing things in this world, not to further God's plan, but to do what human beings should be doing in order to further those plans. There is a limit to human action.